Translation. Completely rejecting all religious activities which are materially motivated, this Bhagavat Purana propounds the highest truth, which is understandable by those devotees who are fully pure in heart. The highest truth is reality distinguished from illusion for the welfare of all. Such truth uproots the threefold miseries. This beautiful Bhagavatam, compiled by the great sage Vyasadeva in his maturity, is sufficient in itself for God realization. What is the need of any other scripture? As soon as one attentively and submissively hears the message of Bhagavatam, by this culture of knowledge, the Supreme Lord is established within his heart. In various places I've been speaking in some detail, analyzing the different words of the first verse of Bhagavatam, and I'm now on the second verse. And I've spoken on most of this words of the second verse. And today I want to concentrate on the words susrushibhi, which Srila Prabhupada translates here as by culture, sadhyaha, once, tatkshanat, without delay. So as Srila Prabhupada in the purport to this verse, he begins by stating, religion includes four primary subjects, namely pious activities, economic development, satisfaction of the senses, and finally liberation from material bondage. So here Srila Prabhupada is translating the first word of this verse, dharmaha. In the word-for-word translation, he translates it as religiosity, and in the purport he says religion, which are similar terms. So in the Vedic culture, there are four principles, which are called the Chari Purusharta. That's mentioned in Chaitanya Charitamrita's Chari Purusharta, Dharma, Artha, Kama, and Moksha, which Srila Prabhupada translates here as pious activities, economic development, satisfaction, and finally liberation from material bondage. So herein, in Srimad Bhagavatam, these four principles are completely rejected. And instead, the Vedyam Vastavam, the actual subject which requires to be understood, is propagated herein. And Sadyo Hridya Varudhyate Takriti Bisu Sru Sibish Takshanat. By hearing Srimad Bhagavatam, even once, then immediately the Supreme Lord is, Srila Prabhupada writes here, become compact, or the Supreme Lord is established within his heart. Now this is in comparison to dharma, artha, kama, and moksha. By performing dharma for a long time, pious activities, one can achieve the result. By performing economic activities for a long time, one can get... Dharma means pious activities. The result of performing pious activities is not immediately received. The economic activities, it takes time to get the result of that. In sense gratification. Of course, sense gratification is the moment of enjoyment passes very quickly, but to make the arrangements for that, it's a big endeavor. And the biggest endeavor of all, to get liberation from material bondage, that's not at all easy. It's very difficult. But Srimad Bhagavatam can immediately Krishna reciprocates with the person who hears Srimad Bhagavatam, so that immediately the Supreme Lord is established within the heart by those who are susrushibhihi. Srila Prabhupada translates this as by cultivation or culture. The usual translation is faithfulness, submissiveness, or what Srila Prabhupada often referred to as a service attitude. So it's very important that by this attitude of hearing Srimad Bhagavatam with faith, submissiveness, and a service mood, then Krishna, who is the subject of Srimad Bhagavatam, who is non-different from Srimad Bhagavatam, who is beyond dharma, artha, kama, and moksha. Love of Krishna is described by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as param purushartha. Krishna bishayak prem param purushartha jar age trinatulla chari purushartha. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu describes that this aim of human life, to achieve love of Krishna, it's the fifth goal of life, which stands far above dharma, artha, kama, and moksha, pious activities, economic development, sense gratification, and liberation from material bondage. And in comparison to love of Krishna, all these, dharma, artha, kama, and moksha, they seem like simply grass, insignificant. Which is why dharma projita kaitava atra. Herein, in Srimad Bhagavatam, the other goals of life which are recommended in the Vedas, they are rejected as being cheating religion, because although they're called purushartha, or the purpose of life, or the purpose of human life, they don't really fulfill the goal of life. If we ask people, what is your goal of life? Some pious people may say, well, to be religious. Other people may say, to get lots of money. Other people may say, I just want to enjoy myself. And very rarely we might find someone who will say, I want to get out of this mess altogether and get liberated from material bondage. But even the desire to become liberated from material bondage, even if one has that goal, and still today there are some people who have that goal, but it's all cheating. It's cheating ourselves of the real goal of life, which is to attain love of Krishna. So if one actually has that submissive attitude, faithful and submissive attitude in hearing Bhagavatam, then by this culture of knowledge, the Supreme Lord is established within the heart. So it's a matter of attitude in hearing. Now this means that in this verse, that there are two kinds of people for whom Bhagavatam is suitable. Often the question is asked that here it's stated, Paramo Nirmat Saranang Satam. Bhagavatam is meant for persons who are completely free from envy, perfectly pure devotees. Yeah, Bhagavatam is understandable by those devotees who are fully pure in heart. And we say, well, then why are we reading it? Or why am I reading it? Or what qualification do I have to read Bhagavatam? I'm not fully pure in heart. So that's true. Bhagavatam is relishable and fully understandable by devotees who are fully pure in heart. But it's also for those who are susru shibihi, those who have this attitude of faithful and submissive hearing. For such persons, they can capture Krishna within their heart. That means Krishna becomes very pleased to manifest himself or reveal himself to such devotees. In this regard, there is a verse later in the Bhagavatam, very beautiful verse. Shrinvata shadhaya nityang grinatas chats vacheshitam kalena narati dirgena bhagavan vishate hridi. Persons who hear Srimad Bhagavatam regularly and are always taking the matter very seriously will have the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, manifested in their hearts within a short time. So all these statements especially in the first and second verses of Bhagavatam, there's There's so much material packed up. There's so many statements packed up in these first two verses. They're all elaborated on and further explained elsewhere in the Bhagavatam. So this point that we're discussing today, sadhyo hridyavarudhyate takra kritibhisu srushibhis takshanat, that those who hear submissively will have the Supreme Lord manifested within their heart without delay. This is again stated here in some more detail in the verse I just read. Shrinvata shraddhaya nityam, those who regularly, shraddhaya, Srila Prabhupada translates this as in earnestness. So shraddha, we know that word generally means faith. The Srila Prabhupada has extrapolated this here to mean in earnestness. If we have faith that the Bhagavatam is Krishna and that our relationship is with Krishna, then certainly we will hear earnestly with attention and eagerness. And grinata cha svacheshtitam, which Srila Prabhupada translates as taking the matter very seriously. Studying Srimad Bhagavatam is very serious. We find that Srila Prabhupada himself, he was very serious about Srimad Bhagavatam, that even though he was traveling all over the world, he took out so much of his time to translate Srimad Bhagavatam and present it for the benefit of the world. So, taking the matters very seriously, svacheshtitam, means by one's own endeavor. Well, there has to be some endeavor. It's not a matter of parrot-like recitation. Sometimes we see in India, or in the people, as a matter of ritual, they recite verses. I had this experience once, some years ago, that a priest in a temple was reciting some verses. He was a young boy, but he was a priest, a young brahmana. So he was reciting some verses, and when it finished, I asked him, what does it mean? He said, I don't know. My father taught me, and this is what we do, and I don't know what it means. So such chanting will not be very valuable. But trying to understand with faith. Now this is very different from persons who approach Srimad Bhagavatam or the subject of matter of Krishna consciousness without faith. There are scholars who Srila Prabhupada referred to as mundane scholars, who study Vedic scriptures but without faith that these scriptures, they represent the truth, that they are transcendental, they can give us spiritual knowledge. In fact, the whole study of what is called Indology was developed in the 19th century by Western scholars with the deliberate aim of undermining the faith of Indian people in these scriptures, and with the deliberate attempt to point out or to try to point out how there's nothing of any real value in Bhagavatam or in any of the Vedic scriptures. Because what happened was the Westerners were confronted with a very strong culture that under hundreds of years of Muslim rule, which was sometimes tolerant but often very intolerant. But the Muslim rulers had not been able to convert the masses of what we nowadays call Hindus to Islam. So the British, they wanted to propagate Christianity, but they saw that people had tremendous faith in Vedic knowledge, and it was a vast body of knowledge. So the first Indologists set about with, they also became somewhat disturbed by seeing that many of the first Westerners who studied the Vedas and the Vedic culture became attracted by that, enchanted by this, and impressed by it. This, seeing this, this is something very deep and very wonderful. So there was a deliberate attempt to undermine the Vedic knowledge by translating and explaining the Vedic literature in a most blasphemous way, actually. So this kind of scholarship, or the scholarship even of even those within the Vedic culture who study Bhagavatam and the bhakti literatures with a preconception that the ultimate truth is impersonal. Or there are so many different schools within what can broadly be called the Vedic culture. The Mimamsakas, they don't have faith in bhakti. They think you just do your work and you, some impersonal God will reward you. Be good and by you'll get your karmic reactions. You'll enjoy life. So such persons have no entrance into Bhagavatam. Persons who can appreciate Bhagavatam, the effect that Bhagavan Vishate Hridi, which means that Sri Krishna becomes manifested within the heart, he becomes manifested within the heart of those who approach Bhagavatam with initial faith and reverence, and he becomes manifest in the heart. Kalena nati dirghena. Doesn't take a long time to become Krishna conscious. If one studies Srimad Bhagavatam and takes the matter very seriously in a mood of devotion. The next verse after this. Very beautiful verse. Pravishta karnarandrena svanang bhava saroruham dhunoti shamalang krishna salilasya yatha sharat. The sound incarnation of Lord Krishna, the Supreme Soul, namely the Srimad Bhagavatam. The Srimad Bhagavatam is the sound incarnation of Lord Krishna. Enters into the heart of a self-realized devotee, sits on the lotus flower of his loving relationship, and thus cleanses the dust of material association, such as lust, anger, and hankering. Thus it acts like autumnal rains upon pools of muddy water. The example is described here, that muddy waters of rivers, when there's rainfall, that becomes clear. So in the same way, all the material bad qualities are destroyed, or they're overridden by the power of the love for Krishna that sprouts up within the heart of one who becomes Krishna conscious by regularly hearing and discussing Srimad Bhagavatam. So in this way, those who can, we'll find in the next verse is described, the verse number 3 of Bhagavatam. It describes that this Bhagavatam is meant for rasik bhaktas, or those who relish descriptions of Krishna, those who are attracted by descriptions of Krishna. Bhagavatam is to be heard and studied, but not simply as an academic subject. Bhagavatam from the very beginning is rasamai. It is full of rasa. It is full of sweetness. It is full of feeling. So Krishna is non-different from Bhagavatam. Bhagavatam is a philosophical exposition of the ultimate truth. Janmadyasa yataha, the source of everything, the param satyam, the supreme truth. But that supreme truth is the supreme loving person, Krishna, who is not simply a philosophical principle or someone to be understood through philosophy, but actually to be understood through bhakti, through loving reciprocation. So this faith, in the beginning there has to be some faith and submissiveness with respect for the subject matter. If one hears in this way, then very quickly one can become Krishna conscious. Krishna will be pleased to manifest himself within the heart of such a devotee. But those who do not have this faith, they can study Srimad Bhagavatam for years and they won't become Krishna, they won't develop any Krishna consciousness, they won't advance at all. They'll probably go backwards by their offensive nature. We may wonder, well, why would anyone study Bhagavatam if they don't have any bhakti? If there's no intention to serve, to develop bhakti, why would they develop that? But there are scholars who do that. There was an edition of Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita written by a scholar. It was his life's work. He made an English translation. He started before Srila Prabhupada started his translation and finished afterwards. It took his whole lifetime to do it. But he didn't have faith in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as the personality of Godhead. It was like an interest for him. Just like some people are interested in stamp collecting and some people are interested in butterfly collecting, and it was his job at the university he was the world authority on Bengali Vaishnavism in the eyes of the mundane scholarly community. So for him it was interesting. He thought it was interesting, but he had no faith in or love for Krishna. So he studied it and he made a book and he criticized Srila Prabhupada's translation therein, thinking his work to be much better. But he didn't get love of Krishna. It's amazing how such a rich work as Chaitanya Charitamrita, incomparably sweet, but even that, which is just for your information, Srila Prabhupada said not to bow down during class when the curtains are closed and open. Just go on listening. This is Krishna also. Discussion of Krishna. So even the Chaitanya Charitamrita, which is the superlatively sweet exposition of Srimad Bhagavatam and all the Vedic literature, even that failed to touch the heart of a person who from the beginning was not faithful. He had a different motive for approaching. So motive is very important. That's why we have to associate with devotees. Scholarship alone is not enough to understand the matter of Bhagavatam. Even any one word from Bhagavatam, or the precise meaning, that is understood by a devotee. Non-devotee, just like the word bhakti, it's often translated as devotion. Srila Prabhupada translated it as devotional service. But the word, it's just one example of a word which is widely used in Indian languages. Everyone who speaks any Indian language knows the word bhakti. But the actual meaning of the word bhakti has to be understood from a devotee. Every Indian person thinks that they know the meaning of the word bhakti. But the actual meaning we have to know from a devotee. Bhakti means anyabhilashita shunyam jnanakama adyanavritam anukulyena krishna anushilanam bhakti ruttama. Real bhakti means without any personal desire, which is fully focused on developing love for Krishna. So if we speak about desh bhakti, or love for our bhakti, devotion for our country, or matri bhakti, devotion to our mother, or kali bhakti, devotion to Kali, it's a misuse of the term. It's generally misunderstood to mean devotion or love, and that's true, it does mean devotion and love, but that Krishna alone is the actual object of devotion and love can be understood by hearing from devotees, and this principle is established philosophically within the Bhagavatam. So Bhagavatam is rasamai, it's full of what is rasa? Vyatitya bhavanavatma. Yes, chamatkara bharabhu riddhi sattvojvale bhadham svadate saraso mataha. Rasa, that's another term which people often think they understand. But when in Bhagavatam the word rasa is used, it doesn't refer to the jara rasa or the dead rasa or the exchanges of mundane exchanges of love. I love you. Famous words. But mundane love is not the subject of Bhagavatam. That's not actual love. Actual rasa is vyatitya bhavana vartma. It's beyond mundane feelings. Feelings but beyond mundane feelings, and which produces a literally a heavy sense of wonder. That can be experienced in a purified heart. Rasa, the rasa of Srimad Bhagavatam is not the, it's not on the level of mundane love stories, Romeo and Juliet or Nala and Damayanti or any such thing. So Bhagavatam has to be heard from devotees. The example is there in Chaitanya Charitamrita, which is the perfect, through the character of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his devotees, is the perfect, again the word exposition or explanation of the principles which are taught in Bhagavatam. So we find therein that there was one poet who had composed a drama which was apparently about bhakti. But it was rejected. His drama was rejected by Sarup Damodar Goswami, who was the secretary of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, that no, you cannot read this to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu because you don't understand bhakti. You think you understand, but you don't. So that poet advised, Sarup Damodar advised that poet, Jao Bhagavata Paro Vaishnava Sthane, go and study Srimad Bhagavatam from a genuine Vaishnava. It's not by knowledge of grammar or study of Sanskrit language, or in the modern age by applying the techniques of comparative religion or comparative philosophy or whatever, multiculturalism or whatever. One cannot understand Bhagavatam. Bhagavatam is a purely transcendental subject matter, beyond the three modes of material nature, non-different from Krishna, which can be understood by Krishna's grace, which is passed down through the Guru Parampara, transmitted through his devotees. If one has this faith, by association with devotees, one attains faith in Srimad Bhagavatam and hears submissively, then Krishna manifests himself to such a person, not to any other person. So there's a brief discussion of the principles of hearing submissively with a service attitude. Susrushaka means one who's like a servant. He submissively takes orders. And how such a person, by hearing Bhagavatam, can immediately capture Krishna, who, through dharma, artha, kama, and moksha, the endeavors in these four lines, one can never get Krishna. Because Krishna is beyond dharma, artha, kama, and moksha. Just like by cultivating apple trees for generations, you'll never get mangoes. It might seem to be the same, similar endeavor, but you won't get the actual result. Whereas very quickly, if one takes to the cultivation of this transcendental Bhagavata process, then very quickly one becomes Krishna conscious. Now in the Vedic culture, in Dharma Artha, in the endeavors for Dharma Artha, Kama and Moksha, there may be discussion of Krishna, or more likely as Vishnu, chanting the names of Vishnu to become free from sins is recommended by the Smarta Sampradaya. So there's some touch of consciousness of Krishna, Krishna consciousness. But because basically dharma, artha, kama and moksha, religion, economic development, sense gratification and liberation are being cultivated, then Krishna is not attracted to such persons. He doesn't reciprocate because there is not bhakti. Pure devotion is not there. But for one who does take to the correct means of bhakti under the guidance of devotees in the approved manner given in scripture, then such a person, by faithfully hearing Bhagavatam, can very quickly become Krishna conscious. So this is the advantage of studying Bhagavatam, that one can very quickly attain a result which janma koti sukritaya na labhyate. Even after many janma koti, after millions of births of mundane pious activity, one cannot get the result of Krishna consciousness, which comes from those who are susrushibhi, eager to serve and hear. Krishna bhakti rasa bhavitamati kriyate kriyatam yadi katopi labhyate tatra lolyam api mulyam ekalam janma koti sukritirna labhyate. This Krishna bhakti rasa, which is difficult to translate, Krishna bhakti rasa, the wonderful feelings which are manifested in pure devotion to Krishna, if one has an inclination toward that, Krishna bhakti rasa bhavitamati kriyatam yadi katopi labhyate. The example is given, if it's anywhere available, purchase it, buy it. This is, of course, an analogy, because we can't buy bhakti. Well, we can, according to this analogy, but what is the price? Tatra lolyam api mulyam ekalam. The only price is to have a very strong desire to be Krishna conscious. That means, when one no longer has desires for dharma, artha, kama and moksha, then the only desire, when the only desire is to serve Krishna, then one can very quickly and easily become Krishna conscious. But otherwise, if one is cultivating pious activities without Krishna consciousness, then even in millions of lifetimes of being a good Hindu, one can never attain pure Krishna bhakti. So that is discussed here and throughout Bhagavatam. Are there any questions on this, please? Yeah.
Hare Krishna. Thank you for my class.
Do we have a book set up here? Okay. CDs also? Yeah. Yes.
Sometimes, even in the association of devotees, when we come in touch with devotees, we start hearing in their association from devotees about Bhagavad Gita or Srimad Bhagavatam.
Yeah.
But sometimes, because of our background, say for
please
example,
don't put them here, because it's the same as putting it on the floor and put your feet there.
The background of today's educational system is such that we are used to study any subject in a particular way.
You study, yeah. Just like some people study grasshoppers, some people study calculus, and then you take to study a Bhagavatam and you think, I'll categorize everything in my mind, and just like I'm getting ready for an exam.
So
that academic approach will not help us. Mundane academic approach will not help us.
So
If we think now I have to get my Bhakti Shastri degree, I have to show I'm a good scholar. With that attitude, you might get a Bhakti Shastri degree, but you won't get pure devotion to Krishna. Bhagavatam is to be. It's not that Bhagavatam is not to be. It's not that Bhagavatam is not to be. Sorry, I'm getting mixed up in double negatives here. Bhagavatam is. Intelligence is to be used in understanding Bhagavatam. But it's not in the same manner like that. Like I was saying, some people study frogs, some people study economics. And you just like, the idea that I am analyzing. The subject matter is to be grasped by, put it in a box, this box, this box, this box, analyze it, use the intelligence. But it's not, Krishna is beyond our mundane categorizing. This is to be understood. By applying our intelligence, we can understand how Krishna is beyond the intelligence and the mind. Yeah. Then?
So how to always remember that I am reading this or I am hearing this for purification of heart and not just for...
How to always remember this? Well, why don't you always remember it?
Because if we try to remember the points in a... Again, as you said, in a technical way, by categorizing them, by analyzing them, then sometimes it happens that the main focus is lost.
Then you hear always from devotees, and if you read Prabhupada's books, you'll get this again and again and again. The same message will come, that simply by an academic process, one cannot understand Bhagavatam. If we study Prabhupada's books and associate with devotees, then, and if we're serious to understand, then we can understand, then we'll hear, and because we have faith, we'll believe it, that simply by our own brain power, we can't understand Krishna. And it's not a very difficult thing to understand, actually. Simply, how much can we understand by our brain power anyway, in any subject? Any subject, even if, whatever you study, any subject, we can't grasp it all. We can't say we understand it all. We can't say we have all the information about it. Of anything mundane, what to speak of the subject of Krishna? So, humility should be normal. If we consider the facts that, how much can I know? Even if I know more than others about something, well, there are so many people who know so much more about other things than I do. And even if I know so much, so what? That intelligence or that ability to remember is not my own ability. If I have, for instance, a motorcycle accident and the brain is all smashed to pieces, then all that knowledge will be lost, can be lost. So just with a little introspection, we can understand that I'm meant to be a servant. I'm not the master of this knowledge. But due to egoism, we think ourselves very great. If we have a little ability in anything, we tend to think ourselves very great. Yes, please.
So it's about submission to Krishna?
Yeah.
Like Muslims are submission to
Allah? Yeah, that's the meaning of Islam, isn't it? Mm. To be submissive to Allah. However, it's not exactly the same. It's a good principle. There are many good things in Islam, no doubt. If one actually follows Islam, one has to get up early every morning, pray early in the morning, fast during Ramadan. So there are many good things. But nevertheless, if we analyze, there is religion in the influenced by the mode of ignorance, by the mode of passion, by the mode of goodness, and transcendental religion. Anyway, that's not really...
They don't believe in praying to pictures or anything like that? One Muslim said, I don't do all the pictures.
Well, I don't want to get into a big analysis of Islam here, because why Islam? Then you can bring Buddhism and Confucianism and Taoism and so many other things. But the point is that Transcendental religion is that which gives knowledge and experience of the Supreme Reality, Param Satyam, who is Krishna. That's not a dogmatic statement, but if we, according to the description, if we see the descriptions of Bhagavatam, the description of the supreme source of everything, the Supreme Lord who is above and beyond, yet involved with everything, yet not involved, if we see the description, this is by far the most comprehensive description or analysis of the Supreme Truth, Supreme Personality, or Supreme Godhead, in that's available anywhere. And we can't find any superior description than this. And Krishna fits the description. So other descriptions, they may be partial, and something's better than nothing. Sometimes, if it's not too much mixed up with misconceptions. So in this way we can analyze.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much for the very nice class. I'm just wondering, would you say that Krishna reciprocates if somebody approaches him with their intellect but in a non-envious attitude? So
if one approaches Krishna with his intellect but with a non-envious attitude, out of curiosity. Well, that's mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, that one of the four kinds of people who come to Krishna, one of the four kinds of pious people, are those who are jignyasu, or those who are simply curious. But those jignyasu people, they're also mentioned as sukritinaha. That means they have some background of pious activities connected with Krishna consciousness. Otherwise, you can be intellectually curious, but without faith. And if there's not faith, that means there's enviousness. Faith means there's the beginning of, from the beginning, if there's a faithful attitude, that means from the beginning there's the willingness to accept Krishna as supreme. So it's a, but if one is more on the intellectual platform, then that means that bringing his ego to Krishna rather than submissive attitude, which is why we see that Srila Prabhupada, as a typical acharya, was often very strong in dealing with people to smash their ego, which simply by discussion on the intellectual platform, it doesn't happen. If you just discuss with someone, well, you think, and then the person goes away and says, well, he had his ideas, I have my ideas, and I'm very intelligent, and he's okay, and nothing happens. So Srila Prabhupada was often strong, and that changed people's lives by cutting through the egoism and making and shaking people, and they realize, oh, I'm wrong, he's right. There are so many cases of Srila Prabhupada doing that. He's not very popular nowadays in our International Society for Krishna Consciousness, but Srila Prabhupada often did that very mercifully. He cut through the egoism. That's the duty of a sadhu, to do that. It's the meaning of a sadhu. What is that verse that... I can't remember that now. There's another.
I want to ask that, as you said, that we should not be involving Krishna conscious movement for the money or for material desire.
Well, I didn't exactly say that, but it's true.
You mean that?
I mean it, yeah. It's a meaningful statement.
So, or for the moksha also. I actually want to know the difference between moksha and spiritual world, because if you talk about Buddha, which also is like Krishna to birth again in this world,
moksha. Well, there's generally the concept of moksha is to merge into the impersonal absolute. And in Buddhism, there is a similar concept, nirvana, which means cessation of everything. Srimad Bhagavatam describes mukti, which is a parallel word to moksha, as muktir hitvanyata rupam swarupena vyavastitihi, being situated, giving up the, or relinquishing the present situation, our false identity, and being situated in our actual identity, which is Krishna, jivesurupoi Krishna nityadas, to be situated as the eternal servant of Krishna. So the idea of moksha, or being released from material bondage without an attitude of service to Krishna, is also a form of cheating religion. And Buddha Dev, he taught that, but that is not an eternal religious principle. He did it, there was a necessity to do so at the time because the Vedic knowledge was being misused for animal slaughter. But he did, what Buddha Dev taught is not eternal religious principles. Alright, so I'll finish there. And Hare Krishna. No, one more question. Hare Krishna, you didn't get your visa?
No, I'm staying here.
Okay.
How do we personalize our study of Srimad Bhagavatam? How do we understand our relationship with the Bhagavatam?
Our relationship with the Bhagavatam begins by understanding ourselves as the servant of Krishna. When we're established in that relationship of service, then the swarup, or our personal relationship with Krishna as a servant, friend, or parent, or lover is established. So first as servant. Then everything else develops after we're fixed in that. That doesn't mean that we study Bhagavatam just in a dry way. Krishna is never dry, and service to Krishna is never dry. Certainly there is praying to Krishna. The Bhagavatam itself is full of so many prayers to Krishna. Interesting, most of the prayers are very philosophical in nature, if you see them. Establishing the prayers of Kunti Devi, of Brahma, of the demigods to Devaki, to Krishna in the womb of Devaki. They very much establish Krishna's position as the supreme and our position as his servant. So that's we're recommended to study to regularly recite various prayers, and we can choose prayers which inspire us in bhakti. That's recommended, to follow the acharyas. The feelings that they have expressed, we should develop anusaran, following the feelings that the acharyas have expressed, rather than trying to make our own avant-garde kind of personal approach. But everything should be guided by the acharyas. Otherwise, there's the danger of mixing up our own imaginative or egoistic ideas with those of pure devotion. So we have, there's so many beautiful prayers of the acharyas, which their ecstatic feelings for Krishna are expressed therein. Yamunacharya Stotra Ratna is there. The Brahma Samhita prayers are there. Bhaktivinoda Thakur's songs. So these are all very suitable for our cultivation of Krishna consciousness. All the truths of the Bhagavatam with the feelings of the pure devotees perfectly expressed are there in. Okay, say something about the books. I'll finish there. Hare Krishna. Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Hare Krishna.
Bhakti Kasai Maharaj ki jai.